Had a question through from a gentleman by the name of Alieg Supran, and he'd been watching the video I did a few months back on implementing iEnumerable, and was asking how we can do this to use iEnumerable to enumerate through the members of an enum, so a collection of discrete values. And actually, I did cover part of that in another video I did, which I'll show you a link to, which was on the yield return key phrase in C#. But the second part of Alieg's question was, what if we didn't have so much an enum, but a class with a load of constants in there, like a set of constant strings and something like that. And certainly that's something that's worth looking at, and we can see various ways we can do it. So I thought I'd just do a quick video this time on how to do that. So the example I put together is this, which is one that actually uses call signs. So many, many years ago, I worked in air traffic control, and one of the issues we had to deal with was that every airline had a three-letter code to identify them, like BAW is British Airways, DLH is Deutsche Lufthansa, and so forth. But then also, when air traffic controllers are talking to them, they don't want to use those letters or indeed the fully spelled out names. So there were shortened names which were standardized for the different companies. So BAW is Speedbird, DLH is Lufthansa, VR is Virgin. So some of them are just the name of the company, some of them have slightly different things. And I've only shown 10 of those there, but there are hundreds of these, one for every airline that exists in the world. So you'd see it'd be quite a big list in practice. And so what we're trying to do here is find a way that we can just have a for each loop that would go through all of those. So in my program, I'm just saying for each C and in call signs dot all, and then we're going to print it out. And I've implemented that all, again, as a static property in this case. So all of those are constants and therefore implicitly static. The class itself is static. And then I've got this static property called all that returns an iEnumerable. And one way that we could have done this would be exactly like we did it in that earlier video with the enums, which is we can use the yield return. So I could just say yield return, first one being BAW, and then if I just copy that out, and then I can use the alt select to select a block there, and pop those in there. And then back in the program, we should see it will now print all of those out when I run that. And so there's the strings represented by those call signs. It's reasonably straightforward to do if you get the copy and paste all right, but you can imagine if you've got 100 of these things, it's going to get quite unwieldy. So you might not want to do it that way. But there are a couple of advantages of doing it this way. One is you're in complete control. So we can determine the order they come out in. Rather than just having them the order they're listed or whatever, we could have them alphabetical or by size of airline or anything you like. And then the other thing we can do this way is we can also, again, as we saw with the enum example, we can have subsets. So if I wanted to have European airlines, then I could have just done a yield return that had BAW and DLH and KLM and so forth for the European one. So we can take control of it like that. But for large numbers, it's going to be quite an unwieldy thing to do. So what I'd actually do is use reflection to automate that entire process. So what we'd in fact do is something like this. Inside our get, we would firstly say type T equals, and then just use type of, and then this class itself, which is called call signs. And then we could say something like var fields equals t.get fields. And then just to be careful exactly what's going on, you can see we've got the overload here where we've got these binding flags, which give us the ability to specify in a bit more detail what we want. So we want to go for only for public ones, because all of those are public. And then also we want to go for the static ones. So that's what we've got there. So that will, in this case, that's all we've got. But if there were other items in this class, we'd at least have filtered it down to just being those. And then what we can do is we could simply loop through those. So we could say for each var f in fields, and then we could again use the yield return, and we could say f dot get value, pass null in there. Just I'll explain what that's all about in a moment. And then do an as string, because we know that these are strings. Now, get value normally is something that's applied when we're dealing with an instance field, in which case you'd have to get the value on a particular object. But because these are static, we don't have an object, so we can just put the null in there. So if I run that up, then you can see we get exactly the same results out of there. So really pretty simple to use reflection to do that. And we can see it doesn't matter how many or how few of these elements you've got, it will just bring those out. In practice, actually, I probably wouldn't use the yield return here for a couple of reasons. The way I'd actually do this would be more like this. I would have a private static list of string, which we'll just call underscore items. And then in here, I could simply forget about the for each loop and just say underscore items equals, and then on that we could do, say, a select for which we need to get the namespace system.link, and then we could say f gives, and then just what we had before, f dot get value null as string, and then because we want to put this in a list, do a to list. And then we could say return items. And as far as that goes, that just works in exactly the same way. So there we've got our results. But there's two further things we can do. One is we can now cache those results. So now I can simply say if underscore items equals null, because this is never going to change, it's all static data, then we populate it. And because using reflection is not super efficient, because you've got to look all this information up dynamically, then doing it once, caching it and getting the results is going to give us potentially some performance advantage. But the other thing we can do is we can also then do things like maybe sort it. So I could here, after we've done that, or even in here, we could then just do something like, space it out a bit because it's going to get busy there. But I could here do something like dot order by, and then s for string gives s. So just order them alphabetically. And so now you see that we're getting them out in alphabetical order. Or we could do them in other ways. We've got more control over that. So that's the way I'd probably do that. If it were actually only these 10, then I might be tempted just to do the yield return and list each one, and because you've got complete control there. But not only is it a question of being a small number, it's also a small and stable number, because if it's unstable, then every time you add a new entry, you'd also have to change the way that your yield return was working. Whereas here, if you add a new entry, it'll just work automatically, it will fit in all of that, and we'll get the result. So a fairly simple idea there, but a use of reflection, which I don't think we've looked at much in any other videos. Maybe some more on that if you're interested. Do ask questions about that. Do subscribe. Do like this video if you liked it. And I'll see you next time.